So tonight we're going to talk about how do you know if your MS disease modifying therapy is working? Have you guys heard that term disease modifying therapy before?
Yes.
Yep. So that we call the our treatments disease modifying therapies in MS because we don't have cures. So therapies are medications that work to try to alter the course of the disease. So we know that in MS, MS is a disease that causes inflammation that will cause damage in the brain and the spinal cord, and that can cause both physical symptoms, so numbness, weakness, balance problems, vision changes, and it can also cause problems with memory and thinking, and sometimes mood as well. So when we select a treatment for you, a disease-modifying therapy, we're trying to select something that's going to work well for you, that's going to prevent worsening of your disease. And so I want to talk to you tonight about that and how do we know that your treatment's working and what do we do to follow that over time. Now, has anybody in the room ever heard of it's a new MS concept, but it's called NIDA? Has anybody ever heard of that? Okay, so I'm going to talk to you a little bit about it today. And it's something that I think is a very good concept. So I have a really light marker, so you may not be able to see this. Let me try look for black. Okay. So we'll go ahead and write this up here. Now, some people in Spanish-speaking countries call this nada.
Okay.
Oh,
this is true.
It's actually true.
Yeah.
So NIDA. So NIDA stands for no evidence of disease activity, okay? So that's what we want, right? We want to find out that we have MS, and then we want you to give us a cure. Well, we don't have a cure yet. I hope that we will someday. But at least right now, the goal is we want to find out you have MS, put you on a medication to then have no further evidence of the disease because we don't want you to get worse. So right now, that's the best that we can do. We can see you at the time of diagnosis and try to stop the disease in its tracks so that you don't accumulate more problems over time. So this is a really neat concept. There are very different formulations of this, but the most common formulation is something that we call NIDA 3. What that means is that you have no relapses. Okay, do we all know what relapses are or attacks? So a new neurological symptom that comes on over hours to days and stays more than a day, typically weeks to months. And then no new spots on your MRI. So we'll call them spots, lesions, you often hear. And then no change in your exam. Okay, and what that means is no change in exam means no disability accumulation. So if you come in March and then we see you again in July and we see that your leg's dragging and it wasn't dragging before, that's a change. So that's a change we don't want to see. So right now, this is the major goal in MS, to basically get a treatment for you that causes no new lesions on the MRI, no new attacks, and no accumulation of physical or cognitive dysfunction. There are other formulations of this that are pretty neat. So we know that in MS, over time, we can have shrinkage of our brain, okay? That will happen to any of us. No matter what we do, as we age, our brain will shrink. In MS, our brain shrinks faster than normal aging. And so with our treatments, our goal is also to prevent atrophy. So this right here is what we call NIDA 3, but a lot of people talk about NIDA 4 that basically includes no brain shrinkage. And that's a word, right? A very fancy medical word. Not really. But I think using weird words like atrophy, sometimes people don't understand that fully. So these are things that we're looking at, and this is the goal. And some people criticize this goal, because if you look at the clinical trials where these medications have been studied, the clinical trials actually show us that when we look as a whole, on average, even when you look back to the early treatments, the first treatments, the injectables, those reduce new disease activity overall by about 30%. So when you look at that and you look at somebody having relapses, if they go on a treatment and they say, oh, I had an attack about every 3 years, it used to be that's okay, because that's what we saw happen in the clinical trials with the early injectables. So, you know, doctors weren't satisfied with that and researchers weren't satisfied with that. And so over time they've come up with newer and newer therapies with the goal of being able to find the perfect treatment for each individual with MS. Now, just because I said with the early treatments, we talked about the injectables, that they, you know, reduce relapses by about 30%, that doesn't mean that that treatment couldn't be somebody's 100%. Because if we look at a bell curve of patients, and we're talking about the average patient, there are some patients who go on that treatment and that's their 100%. They don't have any new attacks. They don't have any new spots over time. And their neurologic exam looks good. And that means that they're on a great treatment. So over time, what we're trying to do when you come into clinic and you get monitored with MRIs, it's a formal recommendation by the CMSC, which is the Consortium of Multiple Sclerosis Centers. They recommend that your neurologist monitor you with an MRI 6 months after starting treatment, every year thereafter. For some individuals, if they've been on treatment a long time, sometimes that's extended to 2. But the reason is that even though MS is behaving on a certain treatment and you're doing well for a couple of years, it's still possible that you could then develop some silent disease activity. And you may have realized that when you go in to see your doctor that you may have more spots than you've actually had symptoms. And that's why we have to look at MRI, because we don't always know when you've had new disease activity. And so I think that this is a really neat concept, because this has really changed how we think about MS. It used to be, well, how many spots or how many relapses is okay before we switch treatment? And this has now kind of changed that, because now that we have all these available FDA-approved treatments, 13 in fact, for MS, we want doctors and neurologists to know, hey, it's no longer okay to leave somebody on a treatment if they've been having a relapse every couple years. They need to try something that might be more effective. Because with each relapse, even though you may have some good recovery, oftentimes you can accumulate some annoying symptoms over time, because it's not always a guarantee that you're going to completely recover with steroids. And so I really like this concept. Some people argue, is it reachable? Because they look at each treatment and they say, you know, well, if we look at the clinical trials and we see what percentage of patients in the clinical trials reached this, it wasn't 100% for anything. But again, that's where we go back to the fact that for particular individuals on each treatment, there was that 100%. And so when we look at treatments that are more efficacious, we also want to think about the safety and the tolerability. And so, you know, this is something that doctors focus on, but I think a really big thing that we should be focusing on and should be included here is quality of life. So we abbreviate that QOL. So that's really important. If we put you on a treatment and your MS isn't getting worse and your exam's not changing and you're not having more shrinkage on your brain MRI and no new spots, we're happy about that. But if you tell me that, gosh, being on this treatment you put me on makes me feel worse than having MS to begin with, or I feel like my quality of life isn't good, I take this medicine and then I feel like I can't go out with my friends because I feel too tired, or you know, this MS symptom is bothering me. So this is a major goal. And finally, this is something that's being looked at. In current day clinical trials, there are studies and questionnaires of what patients report they experience. And I think that's the most important thing, because we look at all these silly doctor things and yeah, that's important, but it's not as important as you telling us how you feel on an everyday basis. And so that's something that if you're on a treatment for your MS, even if it's controlling your disease, but if you don't feel well and you feel like you're having a lot of problems, that's definitely something that should be brought up to your neurologist or the nurse practitioner, whoever's taking care of you, so that they can see maybe it's just the symptoms that you've had over time that we can treat better. So for instance, who has fatigue in this room? Okay. So the question is, who didn't raise their arm? So fatigue is a major symptom in MS. You know, 90-some percent of patients with MS experience fatigue. And that's a big deal. And sometimes that causes people to not want to leave their house or not be able to go out and do fun things with their family or spend time with their kids or their significant other. And there are many things that we can do for fatigue. One of the things is picking the right disease-modifying therapy. If somebody's on a disease-modifying therapy but their disease is active, meaning that their MS is causing new inflammation, that's a problem. Because without controlling that, we're not going to be able to control fatigue. That's MS burning holes in the brain silently. So there are many, many different symptoms, obviously, that could cause problems with quality of life. But the biggest thing is that you ask about them. So what do you guys think about this? What do you think about Nita? I have a special brain, and I was at Camp Connect this past weekend. And so when the kids asked questions, they weren't allowed to answer until they caught the brain. But I won't throw a brain at you guys. I'm going to hand it to you. Because I realize that I'm not really good at throwing. So we'll pass the brain. So tell me what you think. Yeah, absolutely.
All right, so you're really going for no relapses, no new spots, not just reduce. Really, that's what you're going for?
Really.
And did you say that there were patients with no new relapse, no relapses, no new spots?
Yeah, so in the clinical trials, there are a good percentage of patients with every therapy that's been studied who had no attacks and no new lesions on brain MRI and no accumulation of disability. That just means their exam didn't change, so they didn't get worse from a physical standpoint over time. We use this silly scale called the EDSS. Have you guys heard about that, or has your doctor has probably done a neurologic exam in clinic? And every time you're in clinic and we do a neurologic exam, that's something that's calculated off of that. And so that's something that we don't want to see get worse. Now, you make a good point. You said, really? You just don't want to see new spots? What about reduced spots? Well, you're right. I would love to see the spots go away. But right now, the treatments that we have are proven to prevent new things from happening over time. They're not proven to fix what's already happened. And we're not happy with that. Obviously, we would love to have treatments that we can give you to say, yep, this is going to fight your MS and this is going to turn back time. So you know that attack that you had 5 years ago, this is going to fix it. Right now, we're not there yet. There are therapies that are being studied to look at remyelination and repair. And so, you know, I think that someday we will have those types of options. Unfortunately, right now, that's not today. You know, sometimes with lesions that we see on MRI, we may see it, you know, maybe you have an MRI in June of 2015, and then you get your MRI repeated 6 months later or a year later. And we may see that some of those spots go away because our brain has the ability to naturally repair some of the damage that's been done. But still on a microscopic level, you know, we may not be able to see it on the MRI that there has been that repair and that there has been a small scar left in the brain. And that's part of why even when we got better from an attack, so if we had an attack where we're dragging our leg or our leg got numb, but you go outside in Ohio in July and it's 90 degrees out and you get really hot, that's why even though that repair happened and the symptoms went away, when the signals aren't traveling as smoothly because your core temperature is elevated, you can feel those symptoms come back out. And it's not dangerous, but it's just a matter of you having a prior scar there in the brain tissue or the spinal cord tissue. So you're right. I definitely want a treatment that's going to reduce lesions and repair them. But right now, the disease-modifying therapies are not proven to do that. It's a great question. Yep.
One more question. So I was on a treatment, giving my shots every day, and I was getting one relapse a year. Is that way? That's too much then? A doctor would consider that too much?
So I would consider that to be too much. I wouldn't be happy with you having a relapse every year. You know, the problem is that back in the day, you know, if we go back to the 1990s when all we had were shots, there wasn't a lot of options. So oftentimes, you know, you'd be on a shot. We think that it's still, you know, whatever the medicine is that you're still having breakthrough activity, it's probably helping to some degree. But if we didn't have anything better, they would obviously want to keep you on that medicine because it's better than nothing. But now is a different era. We do have many treatments, and so it's really finding the treatment that's going to be best for that individual. Because everybody with MS is different. you know, you talk to other people who have it, and you may have had entirely different symptoms than they had when they came in. And so, you know, when I'm in clinic and I'm looking to select what's going to be the right therapy for somebody's MS, it's really based on several things. It's based on how that person looks. How has their MS course been? Are there risk factors for more aggressive disease? We call those prognostic factors. And so we know off the bat if somebody has more prognostic factors to say that their disease is going to be more aggressive, we may want to jump to therapies that we foresee as being more effective, rather than trying something that might not be as effective as the others first, because the only way that we're going to find out we need a better therapy is every time something goes wrong. And when things go wrong, if it's a new spot or a new attack, that's new brain damage and spinal cord damage. So that's why there's a different model for caring for MS now. It used to be what we called escalation, and some people still do this. I'll erase this. I'm sure you guys have NIDA or NADA memorized now. Uh-oh, maybe this was a permanent. Let's see. I'm in trouble. This is not good. Okay. Let me see if I can get this off. Dry erase. It's just a joke to make me look silly up here. All right, I spent so much time erasing this, I forget what I just told you.
The escalation.
Yes, escalation. So we look at the model of basically starting at, if we look at effectiveness here. Okay. Escalation is we start with the least effective therapy. But oftentimes with effectiveness, with increased effectiveness, we have more safety problems, okay? And so if we want to start with the safest medication, then we're often starting with the least effective medication. And so if somebody has an attack down here, then we move up. And then over time, as they have an attack or they have new spots, we move up the scale in terms of more effective therapies that may have greater risks. And so the problem with that is that each time somebody has an attack or brain, that's brain damage. That's new damage that can't necessarily be restored. And so now there's a different model that's being considered. And this is really, I think, a better way of caring for MS. And again, this is my opinion. But the way we want to care for MS is basically what we call flipping that pyramid. So where we don't start with the therapies that are the least effective, but we actually start up here with therapies that we think are more effective, okay? And if somebody starts with a more effective therapy, as long as safety is being very closely monitored and considered, that may be a better model, just because then we're not putting somebody on the lowest effective therapy and then changing and changing and changing as things get worse, but rather trying to treat it as best we can from the start and maybe just staying on that therapy long term because they do so well. But again, when we're talking about this, you know, we talk about different treatment options. And certainly, as we talk about more effective therapies, things come to our mind like, well, what are these more effective therapies? Well, these are things like natalizumab or Tysabri, Lemtrada, alemtuzumab, fingolimod, Gilenya, Tecfidera. Some of these are the newer agents that are out. And so with each of these agents, there are safety risks. And so that's why it's very important when you make a decision with your doctor what you're going to go on for your MS to fight your MS, that you understand all those risks and that your doctor does and that you guys are both comfortable with a plan of how you're going to monitor that. All right, so let's pass the brain to somebody else.
When we feel fatigued, does that mean something's active?
No, so not necessarily. So fatigue typically is a symptom that people with MS have just because they've had areas of damage in the spinal cord and the brain over time. And so it requires you more energy to do what you need to do. Now, sometimes if somebody's disease is being incredibly active, they can actually, once they're on a better therapy that's controlling their disease, they may feel much better. So I often find when somebody comes into clinic and they're newly diagnosed and they're getting on a treatment, that actually treating them and calming that inflammation results in their fatigue being significantly decreased. Yeah, so that's a good question. So if you guys didn't hear, she mentions, you know, she's had some disease in her spinal cord, but they keep monitoring the brain. So why is that? Should they be getting MRIs of the spine? So classically with MS monitoring, if individuals have had attacks, typically you would have a new neurologic symptom if it was localized to the spinal cord. And the reason is that the fibers are packed so tightly there. So it's hard to get a silent spot just like you would get in your brain. So the brain, there are lots of areas where spots or inflammation can hide. And so if somebody gets a spot in the brain, you may not always know it. If somebody gets a spot in the spinal cord, though, you should have significant symptoms. Now, that's not 100%. So sometimes if somebody's MS has predominantly been in the spinal cord, we will monitor with MRI over time. Okay. So it's definitely something to bring up. Typically for me, with my patients, I do routinely monitor the brain, just like I've said, because lesions can hide there a lot better where somebody might not have had symptoms. And so really what we're trying to capture on MRI is, even though you've looked good and you've been stable, are you having new disease? Does that make sense? And so with spinal cord, we really should see a new symptom or a new problem if you've had a new lesion. But occasionally, you know, we get those every couple years just to check in. Sure. So an attack is when you get any new neurologic symptom, and it usually comes on usually hours to days, kind of how you notice it. It's not usually something that's sudden, like out of the blue, although it could be. MS is strange. Sometimes that could happen. But typically, if you have a new symptom and it has lasted more than a day, that's a definite phone call where you want to call your doctor. If you're not sure, if you've got a symptom and you think, gosh, I'm not sure what's going on, I'm worried about it, just call. I think that's the best thing you can do, because it's very, very hard, especially when people are first diagnosed, to understand what's a concern and what's not. And sometimes we get worried and think we should be really hypervigilant and watch for everything and note it down. And then that can kind of even drive you crazy. And the worst thing that could happen is if you have symptoms and then you end up, you know, feeling like, oh, I don't want to call the doctor, I'm going to go to Google for a while, I'm going to search, and then you see all kinds of crazy things and you get yourself really, really worried. So, you know, I always like it if people call if they're having new symptoms. That's what we're here for. You know, the MS nurses are able to talk to you and understand what you're experiencing and can guide you or get you in to be seen. The other thing that's important to know is that, you know, though, if it is the summer like this and you have noticed that you're heat sensitive, which many people with MS are, not everybody is, but many people are, where they feel like their MS symptoms get worse because they're really hot, that's something to think about. So if you're just outside or you're just in a hot tub and you think, oh my gosh, my arm's numb again, but you sit down in a cool environment and it goes away, then you can feel pretty reassured that that's heat sensitivity. The other thing is if you think you might have a urinary tract infection or you have a cold or, you know, any kind of infection going on, that also raises your core temperature and that can make you feel like you're having an attack. But then once you get through that cold or that infection, you actually feel back to yourself. And so those are things that we're looking at when we see people in clinic. And that's why I don't like to treat relapses over the phone, because, you know, giving somebody steroids when they actually have an infection would actually be harmful and not a good idea. So I would say, you know, if you've got a new symptom that's lasting more than a day, definitely call about it. Or if it's something that lasted less and you're just really worried, that's okay too. Does that make sense or help? Good.
Yes, you brought up urinary tract infections. Mm-hmm. Okay, if that makes your symptoms, say of mobility, worse, how do you determine whether that isn't a relapse? How long do you wait, and you know, what do you have to see happens before you can indicate whether it really was a relapse or whether it was simply from that? Or can that cause you just to get worse without it being a relapse?
So if somebody is having worsening problems, so worsening walking problems, for instance, and we think that they might have a urinary tract infection, typically treating that urinary tract infection will result in that person feeling better back to the same way they were before that happened. And so classically, we wouldn't send that person for imaging, MRIs, anything like that. We would say, let's check your urine, let's get a culture, see what the bacteria is, get you on an antibiotic that's good for that. And then you should take that antibiotic for the full course. And if at the end of the full course you don't feel better, then it's time to scratch under the surface and look for something more. Maybe it's the fact that you got the wrong antibiotic and that antibiotic wasn't good enough for your UTI. But if your urinary tract infection's treated and you've still got new problems, then we need to look and say, okay, this actually sounds like a relapse, a real attack, and whether based on exam findings or maybe your doctor is going to send you for an MRI, would decide on treating that attack at that point in time.
So how long would you wait to make that decision?
Till the end of the antibiotic course.
That soon? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So symptoms should really improve once the infection is cleared. Okay.
Should you be back to your normal mobility pattern? Or?
If you were treated for an infection, you should be back to yourself. Now, that being said, if let's say that you were admitted to the hospital because you had a pneumonia, or you were so sick that you were in bed and you weren't up for several days, you weren't moving around, that can be harder to bounce back from. So when people are in the hospital or they're at home and they're just not getting up out of bed as much, they may take a while to bounce back just because they weren't moving around as much as they were before. Does that make sense?
Well, yes and no. Even with physical therapy, you're really not back to your normal self.
So what are you asking? Maybe I'm missing you here. Okay.
On May 8th.
Okay.
And I'm better now, but it took me 2 months before I could really hardly walk very well at all.
Mm-hmm.
I was barely getting around. And I'm doing better, but I'm still not quite near as well as I was. And I've been doing physical therapy, and I'm almost at the end of that. But I'm just not back to where I was, but maybe that's just my...
Yeah, so again, I think that talking with your doctor and, you know, everybody has individual factors that matter. But typically, again, if somebody has symptoms and they have an infection and they get treated, they should start feeling better after they're treated. Now, like I said, if somebody has significant impairment in their mobility and they really got off because they weren't moving around, we know that if somebody walks with a cane or a walker or is in a wheelchair quite a bit and they get an infection, it takes longer to bounce back. But that being said, if you've gone through an extensive course of PT and you're still not back, maybe something needs to be relooked at. Okay. Yeah, these are good questions. What other questions do you guys have tonight? Who wants the brain? Yeah, so his question is, why is it so hard to come back after you've had an infection? Well, it's hard because when you have physical problems, so this is true for almost every neurologic disease, it's not just MS. When somebody has physical problems, so whether that be fatigue, walking, weakness, if you get an infection, that's a big setback because you're not feeling good already, and you're likely not doing your normal activities. And when you aren't doing your normal activities, you develop what we call deconditioning. So that's a fancy word for you're not exercising, you're not moving around, and so your muscles will atrophy. And when you have weakness already and that happens, that sets you back even further. And so it takes time. And so that's why whenever people are in the hospital, you often see that the physical therapists are visiting them and the occupational therapists, and they're trying to get them up even when they're in bed and they're not feeling well. Because we know that if we don't do that, people can get so much worse. So if somebody's in bed and they don't get up for a couple of days, they try to get up, they might fall over. You know, they do studies of that. You know, NASA has hired people to lay in a bed and see what happens. Have you ever watched that online?
Yeah.
It's true. So even people that don't have a neurologic disease, if you put a cast on their leg and you put them in bed and you don't let them move for months, they won't be able to walk when they get up. They're going to need physical therapy to get better. You're right. So if somebody's in a coma and they're not moving around, so it's very important that we continue to maintain the muscle mass and the neurologic function by moving, range of motion, stretching. And so really it's that setback because of decreased activity.
And I also forgot to ask you, like when I was, when I had the sepsis, how hard is it for the myelin to break down with the blood, with the infection in the bloodstream and
So, can you rephrase that question for me?
Like, I already have a compromised immune system. How hard is it for my immune system to fight off the sepsis when somebody is here?
So, I would say that your immune system is not compromised by having MS. So, in fact, your immune system is overactive because it's attacking your own body. It's attacking your brain and your spinal cord in the setting of MS. And so just because somebody has MS doesn't mean that they can't fight off sepsis. Sepsis, for those of you that don't know, is a blood infection or, you know, any other kind of infection. But if you are on a medication that maybe alters your immune system, maybe it suppresses the immune system a little bit, it depends on the medicine for MS, that could predispose you to an increased risk of having urinary tract infections or other types of infections. So I don't think that somebody with MS is not as able to fight an infection, with the caveat that if somebody's so physically impaired that they can't move, or maybe they're restricted to a wheelchair or a bed, which would be a very severe form, then that individual may not be able to clear their lungs as well if they have something like a pneumonia. And so that can be harder for those individuals to fight infection. All right. Do you have another brain in your hand, too?
Yeah.
He's got double brains, so he gets to ask, like, 20 questions.
You were talking about quality of life earlier with Anita.
Yeah.
I thought you were going to elaborate on that a little bit more.
Yeah.
Because you were saying, like, if there are no new relapses, no new spots or change in exam, you were saying that there's still, like, symptoms that MS can still be, I guess, apparent, and you were saying quality of life.
Yeah, so quality of life means how do you feel? How are things going? Are you having problems with mood or depression? Are your MS symptoms interfering with your day? So you have numbness that's painful, or do you have problems with walking? Or are you having spasms that are so bad at night that you can't sleep and then you feel really, really tired? So quality of life is kind of everything that's happening in your life. And MS obviously is one disease, but that could affect all the other things going on. It could affect your ability to work. It could affect your relationships with friends or significant others or family. And so really quality of life is all encompassing of how you feel. And so really what we're looking at in terms of talking about MS disease modifying therapies and seeing, you know, how does that impact quality of life is that, well, wow, if we put you on a treatment that makes you feel better because it's controlling your MS, and so maybe you have less fatigue, how have you been doing? Do you feel like you're going out more to do things that you want to do that you normally weren't doing? Do you feel like you're sleeping better because you're not having as many problems with, you know, whatever symptom that was painful or annoying? And so that's something that, that we're focusing on, but it really is everything that you experience in your daily life. And so MS disease-modifying therapies, when we put you on them, aren't going to specifically target all your symptoms, but they may overall make you feel better just because you don't have so much inflammation going on underneath the surface. And so if a patient has other symptoms that are ongoing, you know, for instance, like I said, sleep issues, because maybe they're waking up at night to have to go to the bathroom multiple times, they have to urinate, or they're having muscle stiffness or spasms, you name it, numbness, walking problems. These are things that for every symptom, there is something we can do about it. May not take it away 100%, but we can try to improve it. And so those are things that are important to bring up. Does that make sense? Yeah, so you're absolutely right. So with the different disease-modifying therapies, there are side effects. So let's name a few. So with the injectables, obviously when somebody gives themselves an injection, they may experience injection site pain or some type of reaction because they might have redness or swelling. You know, one of the types of classes of injectable therapies called the interferons that came out early, it was really wonderful when that came out, but a large number, over 65% of patients actually feel like they have the flu the day they take the shot and the day after. And so some of those are 3 times a week medications, and so that was quite a challenge for folks. And then obviously, you know, with some of our oral agents that have come out, there's an oral pill called dimethyl fumarate, which is Tecfidera. And some people, particularly when they first start, could experience some GI symptoms. So they might feel like they're nauseous or sick to their stomach or bloated. And we know ways to help decrease that or to try to prevent that. But for not for everybody. It's not 100% for everybody. And that goes away with time on treatment. And there's some flushing where people can feel red and itchy. But many people go on the treatment and they feel great and they don't have any of those side effects. So that's why it's really important to think about that, that quality of life, that tolerability of your medication. Are you somebody who went on X medication and had all the side effects and they're still going on? Gosh, that's not good. Is there something we could do to help decrease those? And if there's not, maybe that's not the right medicine for that person, because we don't want to make you feel worse by what you're taking. Right. Absolutely. Yes. Oh, sorry, you don't have the brain, but I guess nobody has it. Yes.
Something about MS that affects the body temperature regulating mechanism, or you know, because I was talking to my HR person at work, and she gets treated here, and she's been diagnosed back in 1996.
Mm-hmm.
And she was saying you can get cooling jackets. And
yeah.
Things like that. And so I just wanted to, you know, is that more how you know does that just contribute to the fatigue factor, the heat? Is it like a multiplier effect, or?
Yeah, so absolutely. So it sounded like a couple questions in there. So the first question was, does MS cause problems with the body regulating heat? And I would say in general, no. However, we know that the body's thermostat, or what controls it from the brain, is an area called the hypothalamus. That's our temperature regulator. And so I could perceive if somebody had a lesion in that area that potentially they could have problems with temperature regulation. That's not something that we generally see. That sometimes can be seen in the setting of other neurologic diseases that are demyelinating. There's something called ADEM that happens typically in kids, can happen in adults, can go on to become MS, but sometimes we can see that there. But typically in MS, I don't see that. So I don't think if somebody's just feels hot or is sweating that that's very likely to be due to their MS. However, if somebody has MS, if they get overheated, as you said, they do often feel much worse. So upwards of 80-some% of MS patients say, yeah, heat bothers me. But still, you know, I have another, you know, 10-15% of patients that come in and say, I love the heat. It's the cold that bothers me. So it's different for everybody.
Yeah.
What's that?
If heat doesn't bother you, should you still avoid it?
No, and so that's a really important point. So a lot of people think because they say that MS make you feel worse in the heat, that you shouldn't go in the heat. it's really just self-limited. So the heat's not going to damage your brain or your spinal cord. So if you don't feel bad in the heat, by all means, go out in the heat and have fun and do whatever you want to do. If you go out in the heat and it makes you feel bad, but you really want to be out there to do something, go ahead and do it. It's not going to hurt you. It's not going to damage your brain or your spine, but you just know, gosh, I'm going to need to cool off and rest for a while. It might take its toll on me later, and maybe tomorrow I'm going to feel a little more tired. So it's really just what that individual chooses to do, but the heat's not going to harm your own brain and your spine. And that's a really good question. All right. Do you have the brain?
Yeah.
All right, good.
On the psychological side of it, how can you get it across to people that they see you doing something and it's hot, you know, it's a little bit warm, and you're wearing, say you're wearing your cooling vest, and you tolerate the heat better than the cooling vest on, but they also notice you in 70 degree heat that you get tired too.
Mm-hmm.
And it comes down to where some people think you're picking and choosing, you're using your disease to get something you want. Like, I don't want to do this. I don't want to do this for her. I don't want to do this for him. I want to get out of it. So I'm just going to say the heat's bothering me. And how do you get it across to somebody when it's really, it is the heat? I mean, it's, you explained it from kindergarten level all the way up to college level.
Mm-hmm.
It just seems like it just, they don't get it.
Yeah, so it's hard. I think, you know, if there are people in your life that are saying that, it's good to bring them to programs like this. Sometimes, you know, the people that are closest to you don't always believe what you say. For instance, my mom, she thinks I need to take vitamins every day, even though I'm a doctor. Are you just taking your vitamins? That's why you got sick. But that being said, you know, it's good to explain it. All you can do is explain your best. You can refer them to good resources like the National MS Society website. But if they still don't believe you, oh well, who cares?
Well,
you know what you know.
Friends that don't believe it are like, they won't come here because
yeah.
I don't think they really want to know.
Yeah, well, I'm sorry about that. Give me their phone number and I'll call them and yell at them.
When you get that 1 year follow-up MRI, if there are new lesions or new spots, do you then say, oh, this might not be working? Like, you haven't had the relapse, but the MRI has spots. So is that saying the DMT isn't effective, or at what point do you say, let's try something different?
Yeah, so if somebody's been on a treatment long enough to where we feel that it should have been effective, which it sounds like you're saying, you know, if you got an MRI at about 6 months after starting therapy, generally that's when we think, again, for most therapies that they're going to have their effectiveness. Again, not a hard, fast rule, and anybody may argue with you on that. But if then you get another MRI about 6 months later, that's 1 year from starting, and you compare back to that 6 month, if there are new spots on that, that's concerning, because that would be very concerning that it's not protecting you 100% as we want. And so if somebody were having new spots on that MRI that were consistent with MS spots, I would be talking to them about switching to a different treatment.
So really even just one new spot?
So, and again, it depends. So, you know, people have different rules. What I talk to you about is one extreme. That's NEDA, or no evidence of disease activity. And that's something that I pretty strongly believe in. Some neurologists have rules where they say, well, they can't have more than two spots and one relapse or something like this. And I think they're all hearsay. There was a fancy score that was devised by a group, and it's called the Modified RIO score, R-I-O. You can look it up. But they talk about that you've developed a certain number of spots, or you've had a number of relapses, and then based on the number of spots and relapses, they give you a score, and they tell you how to think about switching. And I think that that's silly. Because frankly, if you're having new stuff, that's a problem. And that means that you're open for more disease activity. So again, if somebody has a spot that's in a bad place, that oftentimes makes it easier to say, oh gosh, you had a new spinal cord attack, or you had a new attack in your brainstem. versus a tiny little spot somewhere else. But I would say if somebody's been adherent to their treatment, they've been taking it like they're supposed to and they haven't missed it, and you know, and now we've got this baseline when the treatment should have been working, we've got a new image, I would want to talk to my patient about switching treatments. Okay. Yep, that's a great question.
What about martial arts?
What about it?
Tai Chi works. The more you get control, the easier it is to fight off or keep your symptoms at bay.
So exercise is good. There's no one particular type of exercise, but definitely staying physically fit. It's good for mood, it's good for energy, and it's good for keeping your body in shape. So, you know, absolutely, if it's something that you feel safe doing and that you enjoy, I think it's great. All right, any other questions? Yep.
When you said inflammation, is there any kind of things we should avoid eating that would, like, increase inflammation?
Yeah, so right now there's no, you know, there's no specific recommended diet in MS, but we have seen in recent years there's been more evidence that high salt diet may increase risk of autoimmunity. And so there haven't been enough studies done looking at that, but that's something that I consider. Certainly in America, a lot of us do have high salt diets. It doesn't mean that you have to avoid all salt, but maybe just think about what you're eating. And, you know, I think we should all be thinking about eating, you know, heart healthy diets, because we have MS, we don't want to get another disease in addition to that. Yes. Thank you.
I think the brain has been kind of forgotten, but in my experience, and of course I do not have MS, I have diabetes and arthritis, but I have noticed, well, definitely with the diabetes, but more so with the arthritis, that if I stay away from sugar, I don't have as much pain. And I really think sugar exacerbates inflammation in many areas of the body. I don't know how it might relate to MS, but I know it relates to arthritis.
Yeah, no, that's a great point. So we haven't seen anything to prove that sugar causes MS disease activity. So good news, you can eat your brownies. But sugar itself makes you, oftentimes after you eat it, something looks really good, and then you're like, oh, I feel awful later. So, you know, think about what you're eating. You are what you eat. And if you feel fatigued and tired, you know, some of the foods that you're eating might also have an impact on that. So we'll have time for about one more question here. Oh, it was, you were the one who had a question.
Oh, no, I thought somebody else did too.
No. Anybody else?
No. You're at the
ball. Well, I was going to ask on therapies, on the disease modifying therapies. Mm-hmm. Did you get side effects emotionally from them too? Like mood disorders?
Yeah, so in general, with the disease-modifying therapies currently that we have, there's not a risk of developing, you know, significant mood disorder. However, when the interferons came out, there was a lot of evidence to suggest that it could worsen depression. And so some individuals, if they had depression, people in general have avoided those therapies. We haven't seen that with the other MS therapies, so it's definitely something interesting. You know, mood disorder, depression, anxiety is something that can go along with MS, and so somebody could certainly develop that at any point in time on their treatment, and it doesn't necessarily have to be associated with the treatment. Steroids, if somebody gets steroids for an attack, that can often make somebody feel sometimes really irritable and moody. But other people can feel kind of elated and like they can conquer the world on steroids. So it really depends. Some people really love them. Some people really hate them. So everybody can react differently. That's a good question. Okay. I don't know. I'm not smart enough to know the answer to that question. So let me.
The lady at the desk should be able to.
Okay. Wonderful. So thank you guys so much for coming tonight. I'm sorry I was a few minutes late. If there's any other burning questions, feel free to grab me as I run out. It was good to see all of you.
Thank you.
All right.
Thank you.